The views and opinions expressed by the hosts of this podcast are those of the individual and not of any affiliated companies. Occasional adult language is used.
Welcome to the Sham Talk Podcast, the number one Notre Dame athletics podcast in the world. Today, the guys review the nail-biter game against Duke, talk about special teams, and look ahead to this weekend's primetime matchup against the Cardinals. And now, from the Duncan Student Center, here's your host, Jake Miller.
Well, it is an amazing day for sports fans. The Minnesota Twins today snap their 18-day losing streak in the playoffs and move on to Game 2 against the Blue Jays. For Notre Dame fans, a big win this weekend, the biggest win possibly of Marcus Freeman's tenure. Every game is a playoff game for this team going forward, and they move on. We're happy to break down the action and look forward to Louisville and what comes next. Thank you for tuning in to the Observer and NDFE's Sham Talk podcast with Brett McLaughlin. I'm Jake Miller. Brett, it was a good one, but it was a crazy one, and Notre Dame did not play as well as they should.
No, they did not. And, you know, when you're looking at a game like this, obviously emotions are running high after Ohio State. You come in, you're playing a ranked team, Duke on the road. A sloppy game, but you know what they say, great teams find ways to win, and that's exactly what Notre Dame did with Sam Hartman, two-minute drill, 95 yards for the 4th and 16 scramble. That's his Heisman highlight right now. So, you know, it was a good performance in the last quarter, but ultimately a lot of questions were raised in that game.
A lot of questions were raised. The second straight game, Hartman, for the majority of the game, other than that two-minute drill, he did not play very well. Lots of missed passes. Some of that not to his fault. He was missing his two best receivers. But really, this team over the past 2 weeks has shown that Notre Dame is tight end university. They will use Mitchell Evans.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, he looked phenomenal. You know, he had a couple of fantastic grabs in this game. I think it's important to get him involved. You know, I like with this offense, it's not like last year's where it was very one-dimensional. It was, you know, Mayer was the guy.
Yeah.
This year, we have weapons. Obviously, injuries are going to be a big issue moving forward, it would seem. But as soon as we get those guys back, I think this offense is going to pick up the pace for sure.
They're definitely going to need to, especially in the running game. It was a weak running game. For Estime, I mean, other than the big run at the end, this has kind of been the season for Estime where he sees some big plays, sees some chunks, but his average yardage is down. They were running the ball a lot on first down. Parker was calling a lot of first down, center of the field runs. I personally don't think that's sustainable. The offense seemed to lack creativity at times. Duke has a good defensive line, and it seemed like our plan to counter that was not creative. It was just, to try to play the time game, win the clock, which we typically do, at least in terms of time of possession. But the Irish are going to need to be more creative going forward, especially with the play calling. Some people are saying, what would Marcus Freeman's seat look like? Where would he be if he lost that game? That's an interesting question to consider. I don't know. What do you think? If we lost this game, does Freeman still have a job at the end of the season?
I think firing a coach, you know, this early, especially after the work that he was able to do last season, you know, there's going to be talk about, you know, you lost to Marshall at home, and that was a bad loss. That there's no sugarcoating it. That was a tough loss. But when you're looking at the guys that he had on that team last year, wasn't a lot of people that he recruited. It was Kelly's team, and they still finished 8-4. You know, it was a tough loss to USC, but I felt, you know, most people would say that they were competitive for most of that game. The Stanford one. Don't have an explanation.
No explanation.
That one,
terrible.
That's one that you're going to go back and look at and say that was a blip. But Ohio State, you know, especially playing, you know, your starting quarterback Buckner gets hurt, second game of the season, you play the entire year with a backup, make a bowl and win a bowl game. It's impressive. But you know, if he happened to lose, you know, back to back weeks to ranked teams this season, you'd have questions because at the end of the day, you know, Notre Dame was favored in this game. And this was a game that they had to win.
Yeah.
You get absolutely heartbroken at the, you know, 1 second left on the clock last week against Ohio State. And how do you respond? And honestly, when they came out, I thought they responded great. You know, the offense looked strong. They started moving the ball. But then as the game went on, you know, Mike Elko, great coach at Duke, made some adjustments, and the game became a much more even match. And I think, you know, as a coach for Marcus Freeman there, that's a game that you have to win. It's good that he won, but that was a game that I was really expecting to see an angry team, almost a team that was ready to absolutely dominate whoever they played. Because when you lose on a last second like that, the last thing you want to do going into next week is play a game very similar and have to win in the last second.
It's a team that definitely didn't come out angry. It came out conservative. They were going to play how they wanted to. They had that 13-0 lead going in. But no, I agree with you. It's a team that didn't bring out some of the spark and some of the fire that it probably should, especially on your play calling side. After a big loss like that, your guys want to win. Your guys need to win, especially some of these guys who, if they're not playing in the playoff, there's no reason for them to play college football. Guys like Estimate, guys like Hartman, who are going to the draft, right? They're not going to want to play, or they're not going to give it their all in meaningless games. And they shouldn't. They shouldn't have to do that. But we got the win. We're going to move on. An interesting game. The smallest, one of the smallest Power 5 stadiums. Smallest stadium in the ACC. It sits about 40,000. The Duke fans were there. They're not a great fan base for football. We'll say what we want for basketball. But the Duke fans were there, and they were disappointed and shocked after the Estimate run at the end of the game.
Yeah, that that was a tough break as a Duke fan. Obviously, this was kind of the kind of running game that we were expecting from Notre Dame going into that game.
Yeah.
We were expecting these long runs. You know, Duke has a pretty good defense. They're 19th in total defense in the NCAA. But you would really expect, again, coming off a loss like that, you would expect an angry team, a physical team, and a team that wants to dominate, a team that wants to win. Because at the end of the day, the season was on the line in that game. If Notre Dame goes to Duke and loses, playoff hopes are gone, and realistically, a New Year's Six bowl is not
totally
in the picture anymore.
No.
You know, that's two, and furthermore, the other thing you have to consider is that's two ranked losses that this team has not beaten a team that was, you know, I would say competitive up until this point this year.
Yeah.
And, you know, they showed that they could hang with Ohio State, but they couldn't get it done. So, you know, were we to go down to Duke and lose that game, that just raises a lot of questions. So it was good to see that win. And,
Notre Dame survives its first test. A mini test in the game that it definitely did not survive was continued poor special teams. In the words of RJJ Post, special teams make special teams. In the words of Coach Prime, our special teams weren't special. Spencer Schrader, this man has a huge leg. He kicks the ball sky high, and yet again misses another easy kick within 30 yards. If you're Freeman going forward, do your calls, you go for the field goal at this point or you don't? Does that change now after some of these easy misses?
Well, I'm not one to come out and criticize, you know, players. I would say, unfortunately for Spencer Schrader, those aren't great misses. But
no.
When you go back to look at the Ohio State game, and I bring this up, he misses a field goal in the first half. They do not attempt another field goal the entire game.
Which, were we ever in distance to be able to?
Yeah, we would go for it on fourth and one.
Yeah.
Right? Which, in my mind, that sends a message to your kicker that you're not confident in him to make it.
Yeah.
So I think right there's an issue. You know, I think if you're the head coach, if you're the special teams coordinator, you have to confirm that that's your guy. He has to feel, you know, that he's the one who you want taking these kicks. And obviously, as we approach some more difficult games, you know, USC, for example, every point is going to matter in that matchup. Even Louisville, I could see field goals becoming a pretty, you know, nice thing to have on the scoreboard. So you want your kicker to be confident, but you also want him to make these. So going forward, I would say, you know, you got to stick with him, right? But
no, there's no other option. I completely agree with you. And you have to take field goals, especially ones within 40. But it's, you know, this was a guy that Notre Dame got from the University of South Florida. They saw him play here back in 2020 when he was, you know, on University of South Florida and they came here. But, yeah, it's Freeman maybe didn't get the best guy in the portal he could have. You would think it was second or third team in the American when he was there. Is he a Notre Dame quality kicker? Is he going to be able to make those big kicks going forward? We'll have to see. Something to point out, though, is that this game stayed competitive because the kicks kind of evened out. Duke's kicker, sophomore Todd Polino, also missed a kick within 40 yards at the very end of the first half. So both teams, we'll call it net zero there. But in the future, the teams want to stay competitive. They're going to need to make those kicks. One other thing to mention on special teams is low returns, especially on the punt side. Chris Tyree, you know, Coach Marcus Freeman told Tyree that he needs to be aggressive, especially in the game. Tyree bobbles a punt, a very kind of strange punt that he dove on. Didn't make a lot of sense why he took that at all. But Notre Dame has not seen great production out of the kick or punt returns. Will they just be conservative? You know, Tyler Horker, our good friend, was sitting next to me, and he pointed out that Duke had a 28-yard return, a great return, an awesome run. But with all that risk, they got three more yards as a touchback. Maybe this is a team that should just utilize the touchback more.
I would say in terms of the touchback, I would take it. That as if I were a coach, that's my philosophy.
You're no injuries, right?
No injuries. Simple. Obviously, we know that kickoffs are the most dangerous play in football. No injuries. You get the ball at the 25, and you get good field position.
Yeah.
You know, if there's space and you think you could make it, go ahead. But a lot of the times you see guys take it out of the end zone. They get to the 20. They barely make it back to the 25. Right? So I would say, overall, I'm a fan of taking the touchback.
Definitely something to consider. And as we wrap up talking about Duke, we got to talk about one more thing that's on the message boards, it's on the Facebook groups, and everybody is talking about what Notre Dame has seen officiating wise so far this year. A little bit of context: for most of its games, Notre Dame utilizes ACC referees. So for example, for Ohio State brought its Big Ten referees, but whenever Notre Dame goes to an ACC stadium, ACC referees, and for some home games, especially those when we host ACC teams, ACC referees as well. And there's this idea, this mantra that these ACC refs have a bias against Notre Dame, that Notre Dame's being rigged, that Notre Dame is being unfavored. I mean, Notre Dame has drawn a lot of penalties. We'll get that in a second. They had 8 pre-snap penalties in a delay of game against Duke, and Duke was not a loud crowd, 40,000 strong. But you know, is there some sort of bias? Is this a dumb myth? Is it a way that fans are just expressing their anger? What do we think?
Well, now that we're on the topic of penalties, I can bring up some statistics for us.
Yeah, let's take a look at it.
So Notre Dame this year has played 2 ACC opponents. They were NC State and Duke. And in both of those games, they were penalized 10 or more times for over 70 yards a game. When you look at their next closest games in terms of penalties, it's Ohio State and Tennessee State at half that at 5. So I'm not to say here that, you know, the ACC referees are calling more. Perhaps it's just that in these, you know, as you'll notice, NC State and Duke, they were both on the road. Perhaps this team is less disciplined on the road, right? There's a lot of different factors here. But it is a little interesting to bring up that point. And I would say I'm not quite sold on the idea yet. Maybe my tone will change through the season. But for now, I'm going to say that I think it's just a way that, you know, us fans have come to accept these numbers of penalties.
My take is that this is the dumbest idea ever. There is no myth. It is a complete myth. Complete myth. There is no bias against Notre Dame. Notre Dame is a sloppy team. It looks like they're a very physical team, but they're a team that gets sloppy at times. Has Notre Dame had several penalties? Yeah, you know, there's been several targetings. Devin Ford took a big hit against Tennessee State. This weekend, a couple of close calls. You know, people are saying there's missed holds, especially against Ohio State. Missed pass interference calls. We're getting called more than the opposite team. And my take is that you really have to look at each one of these calls by itself and make it a decision. Each call is a decision. And are there mistakes? Sure, but I don't see any sort of pattern or any sort of practice in the mistakes itself that leads to thinking that there's some sort of bias against Notre Dame, that the referees are trying to fix the game in favor of the ACC opponent. That's just absurd. And we take a look at Tim Donaghy. Tim Donaghy, longtime NBA referee who actually fixed games. The word got out. It was obvious over the long span of time. But we live in a world today that's very digital, that's very accessible and very open. If there was something like this, all it would take would be one person to report it to ESPN or Fox Sports, and there would be a scandal. Yeah, exactly. And ACC, the ACC would blow up because of that. Forget Clemson or Florida State leaving for another conference. This conference would be dead overnight. Lawyers would find a way to get out of it. There is no reason that the ACC would instruct its officials to have some sort of bias. Obviously, ACC wants its teams, its full members, to be good, to be strong, to be a winning conference. But when the ACC signed this mega deal with Notre Dame, the football scheduling agreement, separate from the ACC membership, they knew that most of these small teams will not beat Notre Dame. But they saw it as a great place for some of these small teams like Duke and Syracuse, who typically wouldn't get the opportunity to play Notre Dame, to not only play Notre Dame, but to host those teams, to host Notre Dame at home. And that brings your money.
I would agree. Just going back to the idea of fixing the game, were you to have a scandal like this, that would absolutely be the end of the ACC. I'm sure, if not already, Florida State, Clemson, Virginia, North Carolina are already trying to break down the grant of rights. This, I think, would be the nail in the coffin. The SEC would have four more teams by tomorrow morning. So I don't think something like this is happening.
We got a lot more to cover looking ahead to Louisville, looking outside of Notre Dame to the college football playoff. We'll cover all of that on the other side of a word from our friends at Amazon. You're listening to the Sham Talk Podcast.
You're listening to the Sham Talk Podcast, the number one Notre Dame athletics podcast in the world. We appreciate your support, and we're constantly looking for ways to improve the listener experience. In order to do that, we need your help. We have a pretty cool relationship with Amazon.com, and we'd like to invite you to join us. Amazon recently sent us a special link. When you use this link to buy something from Amazon, we receive a small percentage of the order. Best of all, it costs nothing extra for you. The link is available on the screen and in the description below. Once again, before you head to Amazon, start with our link. It doesn't cost you anything extra, and it helps us provide you with the best possible listener experience. Thanks for your support. And let's send it back to the guys.
Well, a big thank you to our friends at Amazon. Another reminder, before shopping at Amazon, use our link. Costs you nothing extra and really does help improve the quality of the podcast. Brett, let's take a look at the college football playoff. Notre Dame looking from the outside in. But really, are there four teams that are cemented in that spot?
Absolutely not. No.
No.
This, and what is interesting about this year is this would be the perfect year for the 12-team playoff. Because I would say, looking at the AP poll right now, teams 1 through 12 would make a fantastic playoff. And, you know, it's unfortunate that this year we're only down to four, but in fact, I would say it would make the regular season more exciting. Now, going back to what you said, do we have four top teams that are guaranteed to make it? No. Georgia has been number one for a very long time, right? They did not look good against Auburn.
No. Beck does not look good.
No, no, no. And Auburn is not, you know, Hugh Freeze is building up this program. But Auburn is not ready to contend for anything within the SEC. Not at all. And the fact that they were able to, you know, keep Georgia at bay for that long suggests that maybe there's a problem with the SEC powerhouse. Going on to two, looking at Michigan.
Yeah.
Michigan has to play Ohio State and Penn State.
And they haven't played anybody so far.
Played anybody.
No.
Texas, big matchup this weekend against Oklahoma. That'll tell us more about what the Big 12 is going to look like.
The computers don't like them in this matchup. Everybody's saying Oklahoma here.
Then you go to Florida State. Florida State to me is interesting because they had a big win against Clemson and a big win against LSU. But now LSU is not looking like the team that we thought they were at the beginning of the season after just losing to Ole Miss.
Yeah.
Now, could I see them winning the ACC and going undefeated? Absolutely. Could I see them dropping three games? Absolutely.
Yeah.
So Florida State, in my mind, has a lot of question marks. Then we go to the Pac-12, and I love the Pac-12 this year, but I'm expecting Washington, Oregon, USC, Utah, Washington State, Oregon State to all beat up on one another.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if we're going to have a clear undefeated Pac-12 champion.
My take is that even if your Pac-12 champion has two losses, is there any consideration there? Is there anything by the committee that says we want to honor the Pac-12 in its last year in its form? These teams look good against each other. Or do you just continue to use the same premises that, yeah, we're looking for one-loss teams?
I think it would have to depend. You know, and the reason why I say that in this situation is Georgia this year plays almost nobody.
Yeah.
Their most difficult game will end up being
Kentucky,
Ole
maybe?
Miss. I would say Ole Miss,
okay.
Yeah. But when you look at the Pac-12, Washington will have to play several ranked teams. Oregon will have to play several ranked teams. And I think at the end of the day, strength of schedule this year matters, right? Because we could say, and there's an argument to be made for Michigan to be number one right now. They've looked the most complete, but they also haven't played anybody yet. We haven't seen them play against a ranked opponent, nor I don't think they've played a single team that's been receiving votes for the AP poll.
No.
So how good are they?
They're definitely unproven, but they look composed. Very few penalty yards. They go on the road to Michigan and NBC's big Saturday night tonight, this weekend. We'll have to see what that looks like going forward. My take is that if I were to put a team right now in the one spot, I would want to put Washington there. And I don't love Washington, but I think that their offense is by far the best in college football. Their defense scares me. The past 2 weeks, they've kept it close. They kept it close with Arizona this week. Week before, they let Cal Berkeley score a bunch of points. Adult language is allowed. It's on the disclaimer. But I don't think they're a solid team. I don't think they're a team in the end that's going to be able to compete with another opposing offense, somebody like Texas or Michigan. But what they've done so far deserves credit.
I would agree. I like Washington. But that being said, I don't see Washington even winning the Pac-12. Oregon interests me. Now, Oregon absolutely demoralized and shut down the primetime train that was going on. Now, I love Colorado. I love what Deion Sanders is doing in Colorado. But this Colorado team is not yet ready to contend for
no,
a title.
No, they're not.
I would say give him 2 or 3 years, and then I think we're having a different conversation. But as of right now, I would say Colorado is not at the level that they were maybe thought to have been 2 weeks ago. Oregon interests me, though, because it seems that every year Oregon is hyped up as a very good football team, and most of the time they are, and then somewhere along the line they lose and they miss out and they crash out of the playoff picture. I'm not sure when it's going to happen. Perhaps it happens when they play Washington.
Yep.
But Oregon, I think, right now, from what I've seen, is the most complete Pac-12 team. Because you look at USC, there's no defense.
No.
Right? No defense in USC. Washington State, I like Washington State, not expecting them to contend for the title. Utah just lost to Oregon State. Now, Utah's interesting, actually, now that I bring them up. You would not expect a team like Utah to be playing as well as they are, considering they're missing so many
exactly,
players.
Exactly, yeah.
So I think once Utah gets healthy, they could be scary. And, you know, we've already seen that they've had Southern California's number for the past year and a half. So we'll see.
Notre Dame obviously needs to win out. Every game is a playoff game. The path is simple and straightforward for them. But what might Notre Dame want to see? And for me, it's they probably want to see teams also win out.
Absolutely.
Teams to be undefeated and for it to be a simple thing where you have your best SEC team goes undefeated and gets in. You have one team in the Big Ten that's by far better, maybe Michigan. I think Michigan is the best team in the Big Ten. Michigan wins out in both Ohio State and Penn State end the season with 2 losses. Same could be said for the Pac. I think the Pac will have one better team. What's scary, though, is Texas legit? Is Oklahoma legit? Are one of those teams going to be favored over a Notre Dame team? Is Florida State going to be able to keep producing and go undefeated? I don't know. What are your thoughts?
So looking at the playoff picture for Notre Dame, very obviously you need conference championships. You need undefeated teams to win the conferences.
Mm-hmm.
Except for the Pac. I would think for the Pac-12, you want chaos. You would want a 1 or 2 loss USC to win. And this is predicated on the fact that Notre Dame goes undefeated. Because if Notre Dame goes undefeated, they would hold wins over Clemson, USC,
yep,
and I guess Louisville.
And maybe Duke.
And Duke, sure, Duke, right? So you would want Ohio State to win the Big Ten. Because if Ohio State wins the Big Ten, you lost them last second touchdown. That loss looks a lot better for you. You would want both Michigan and Penn State to have at least 1 or 2 losses, right? You would want, and there's going to be an SEC team in the playoff no matter what. We know that the playoff committee and the sports writers, they love the SEC. So all these articles out there saying, what would a playoff look like without the SEC? It's not going to happen. Doesn't matter how mediocre the SEC champion looks, they are getting in the playoffs. So I would say you would want Georgia because Georgia's yep. undefeated. They go undefeated.
And they don't look good. You want to play Georgia.
Exactly. Yeah. But you'd want to play Georgia, and Georgia undefeated would hand every other SEC team then would have 2 losses, which would eliminate them from the playoffs. And then in terms of the Big 12, I think you want to see them, you know, beat up on each other.
Yeah.
You'd want to see Oklahoma, let's say, beat Texas and then lose to Kansas State. You'd want to see this parity in that conference. And for Florida State, maybe they lose to Duke. Maybe they lose to Wake
yeah.
or Miami. I could actually see them losing to
Miami.
Do they
play UNC?
Does Florida State play UNC?
I can look it
up.
They
do not.
Ooh, well, maybe they'll find them in the championship game. UNC's offense, there's something else.
Yeah, I mean, Florida State plays Duke and Miami. Those are their 2 ranked teams
yeah.
left. I could absolutely see them losing to Duke, and I could see them losing to Miami.
For sure. We'll definitely have to take that in consideration as we keep going. But an interesting college football playoff picture, it definitely shows you that You say, yeah, it would be an ideal year for the 12-team playoff. Yes, but isn't it so fun condensing it down to four teams? I mean, it makes every game so meaningful in the context of the regular season. And I think for Notre Dame fans, yeah, you're going to be able to lose more games and have the season still be meaningful going on down the road, but it's so fun to have it be such a high-stakes game, everything. Let's talk a little bit about what to watch for in this Louisville game going forward. For further coverage on this, take a look at the Irish Insider launching Friday at the Observer, or NDTV's full show launching Friday night about everything but Louisville. But Brett, what are a few takeaways, a few things to watch for when the Irish go down the road down to Louisville?
So the only information that we would really have on Louisville and how this matchup is going to shape up is between a common opponent and NC State.
Yeah.
Now, Notre Dame beat NC State in the Monsoon Bowl a few weeks ago, 45-24. Hartman threw four TDs but had his only turnover of the year in a fumble. The Cardinals played NC State last week, played them at home. Plummer had one touchdown, two picks. And so I think when you're looking at this matchup, you want to make Plummer uncomfortable. You want to put him in situations to force him to make plays. Because as we see, NC State was able to do that, and they were able to keep themselves in this game for a very long time. And if you're Notre Dame's offense, you want to get back to that pre-Ohio State form.
Yeah.
You want to find ways to spread the ball around, to run the ball, to make this offense multidimensional.
I think you're going to see a lot from the passing game. Estime's been going hard a lot recently. Payne's been going hard. You maybe give them a little bit of a break. And guys like Thomas and Merriweather, if they can get back on the field, which we do expect them to do, to spread the ball out a little bit more, and hopefully by the third or the fourth quarter, Hartman's able to take a nice seat on the bench and we can bring in the backups. Should be a good one. What are you thinking about the score?
Yeah, so I think when you're looking at this, I would love to say that we're going to see a Notre Dame blowout victory here. Obviously, Louisville's a top 25 team. They are 5-0. They are a talented squad. But this is a Notre Dame team that needs a win, and they need a big win. That being said, I'm not sure if we get that here. I'm going to say Notre Dame 42, Louisville 33.
Okay, well, I was afraid you were going to say a Louisville win, which isn't allowed here, my friends. We're neutral coverage, kind of, but the Irish have to win a game like this. I'm going 30-7. I think this is finally the game where Notre Dame can take a little bit of a breath. It'll host USC, obviously, next week, and it'll be a big, big game here in South Bend. A lot to watch for, and continue to join us on the Sham Talk podcast. We'll have another episode looking forward to everything related to Caleb Williams, our good friend Lincoln Riley, a terrible defense, and everything related to USC in the Irish's biggest game in the rest of the season. For Brett McLaughlin, myself, thank you for listening to the Sham Talk podcast. Check us out on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, or the Observer website. I'm really grateful for all of your support. Want to thank
you. If you enjoyed this episode and you'd like to help support the podcast, please subscribe and leave a rating and review. To stay up to date with Sham Talk and get all our behind-the-scenes content, you can follow us on Instagram and Twitter at Notre Dame Television. That's all for now. Thanks for listening, and go Irish!